He appointed whomsoever he will. And then he puts in there, even the basest of men. And if Nebuchadnezzar had only known that and had said, I'm grateful for what I have. I do not merit it. I'm grateful for the position I hold. I do not merit it. And if he was not grateful, that's why he came to the problem he came to. Now look at yourself now today. And see what you have. And see what you do. And then see, couldn't God have found a better person like you? Of course. A more knowledgeable person than you are? Of course. Couldn't God have found a more spiritual person than you are? Of course. And then put him there. Whatever privilege you had in the house of God or in society, in the world, anywhere. Couldn't God have found another person to replace you? Yes, he could. That should make you humble. That's what Nebuchadnezzar was not thinking about. He was thinking about his greatness and his height and his loftiness and what he had. It says, the king spake and said, is not this great Babylon that I have built for the house of the kingdom by the might of my power and for the honor of my majesty? That's the thing that came out of his mouth, and that was the pride. He himself recognized that later as pride. Hey, look at chapter verse 37. Now I, Nebuchadnezzar, praise and extol and honor the King of heaven, all whose words are truth, his ways judgment, and those that walk in pride, he is able to abyss. Let's look at Isaiah chapter 14. Isaiah chapter 14, and let us see the perception and the personification of pride. Isaiah chapter 14, we're looking at it from verse 13. Isaiah 14, verse 13. Here we're told in the word of the Lord, it says, for thou hast said, where? In thine heart, understand? You may not even talk at all. You may not even open your mouth and say anything. In thine heart. And God recognizes it there. And God knows it there. And thou hast said, in thine heart. What did you say is that? I will ascend into heaven. I will exalt my throne above the stars of God. I will sit also upon the mount of the congregation in the sides of the north. I will ascend above the heights of the clouds. I will be like who? The Most High. He was a created being, and God gave him a good position. But that wasn't enough. In his heart, can you imagine somebody who is envious of God, the Creator? Can you imagine somebody who is envious of the Almighty, the Most High? And he said, I will be like the Most High. Can you imagine what son is envious of the Father? Can you imagine what student is envious of the professor? Can you imagine what employee is envious of the employer? A creature envious of the Creator. By the way, when it says, in his heart, that's where pride sits. You look at Deuteronomy chapter 8. I'm reading from verse 2. Deuteronomy chapter 8. And we're looking at verse 2. It says, and thou shalt remember all the way which the Lord thy God led thee these 40 years in the wilderness, to humble thee and to prove thee and to know what was where in thine heart, whether ye would keep his commandments or no. And that's the interest of God. It's not just looking at the words we speak. It's not just looking at the dress we put on. It's not just looking at the things we build around ourselves. It's looking at in thine heart. Because that is where the pride actually originates. In verse 17 of that, Deuteronomy chapter 8, verse 17. And thou shalt say in thine heart, my power and the might of my hand has gotten me this wealth. In thine heart. You may be so shy, you don't say it to people. And you may think that people will kind of say, but that's pride if you say it to them. But in your heart, every time you're going on, when you look at another person, you look at that person, you size him up. And then in your heart, I'm higher than this, I'm greater than this, I'm holier than this, I'm more important than this, I'm more significant than this. The work I'm doing is more important, more significant than this one. In your heart, you may not say it out. You may not even wear something flamboyant. Your clothes may not be flamboyant, and your look may not be flamboyant. You might be able to kind of condition yourself, and people think you're humble. You might be bending to everybody whenever you are. You see them, thank you, sir. Good morning, sir. But in your heart, in thine heart, my power, my might, my education, my experience, my expertise, my skill, my ability has gotten this for me. That's the pride. It's in the heart. We're looking at Deuteronomy chapter 9 verse 4. Deuteronomy chapter 9 verse 4. In thine heart. Chapter 9 verse 4. It says, speak not thou in thine heart. No, don't even tell you in the privacy of your room, where you are, all alone by yourself, in the thought, in your inner man. Don't even say that, because there's pride. It says, speak not thou in thine heart, after that the Lord thy God has cast them out from before thee, saying, for my righteousness the Lord has brought me in to possess this land. But for the wickedness of these nations, the Lord does drive them out from before thee. It says, don't even say that in your heart, I'm better than this. You know the story of the children of Israel. As you look at the children of Israel, and then you look at the Egyptians, are they better? No, they're not better. And you look at the Canaanites, look at all the idolatry that all the Canaanites went into. And when eventually Israel got into the land of Canaan, didn't they worship the same idol they did? And so the Lord is saying, don't ever say in your heart, I'm better than the Canaanites, I'm better than the Amalekites. That's why the Lord has brought me in, and that's why the Lord has destroyed them. He says, no, this is grace, this is my mercy, this is my gift, because of my covenant with Abraham. Don't ever say in your heart, I am where I am because of what I know I can do and what I have got. Don't say it in your heart, because that will be pride. We're looking at Isaiah chapter 47. Isaiah chapter 47, in thine heart. 47 verse 8. Isaiah chapter 47 verse 8. Therefore, hear now this, thou that art given to pleasures, that dwellest carelessly, that sayest in thine heart. The Lord is always looking at how to say in your heart, how you carry yourself, what you think about yourself. And that's why you trample on other people. That's why you push other people down. That's why you have no regard, no respect for other people, because of what you say in your heart yourself. That's why you look down, belittle, minimize, commonize other people. Who is this and hands of all people talking to me like that, because of what you say to yourself in your heart? And that's where pride begins, the perception and the personification of pride, that the Lord is saying, what you tell yourself in your heart. And that's where it began with Nebuchadnezzar. Then it came out after 12 months. It wasn't that they began to think about that. He had been telling himself in his heart, I am. And who else is available here? Who else can do anything over here? Because I am, and there's nobody else that can compete with me. So the Lord said, therefore hear this now, thou that art given to pleasures, that dwellest carelessly, that sayest in thine heart, I am and none else beside me. I shall not see it as a widow, neither shall I know the loss of children. Verse 10, for thou hast trusted in thy wickedness. Thou hast said, none seeth me. Thy wisdom and thy knowledge, it hath perverted thee. And thou hast said in thine heart, I am and none else beside me. That's the problem, in thine heart, where that thing appears. We're looking at Obadiah. Obadiah has only one chapter. We're looking at verse 3. Obadiah, verse 3. the pride of thine heart. You see, it's in the heart. The pride of thine heart has deceived thee. Thou that dwellest in the clefts of the rock, whose habitation is high, that saith in his heart. He says it in his heart. And what does he say? Who shall bring me down to the ground? That's a very dangerous thing. You know, look up here, brothers and sisters. Have you heard about, you know, in the politics of our land? And they say that the immunity of this one leadership, the president and the governor and all the other, the senators and everyone. And if you keep the immunity there, what that means is that while you are there, the law can never catch you. You are not under any control of anybody. You are above the law. And when you say in your heart, I am here, I am here. I am the leader here. I am so and so here. I am such and such here. And I carry immunity. That means I carry a such protection. My office, my position grants me that protection. And nobody dare touch me. Now in the church, we don't have any immunity like that. But you might think in yourself, if they dare touch me, the whole church will rise up and this church will scatter. And this church will riot. They have never seen riots in this church before. But if they ever dare to touch me, and they try to correct me and say, no, you are not to be there, you are to be here. I'm telling you, the position I have, the popularity I have, the prestige I have, if they dare touch me, this whole church will scatter. And they don't want the church to scatter, so whatever I do, they just leave me alone, because I say in my heart, I am and there is none else. That's a very dangerous position for you, because God has 1,001 ways to be able to bring that proud heart down. Let me show you again over another verse 3. The pride of thine heart has deceived thee, that dwellest in the clefts of the rock, whose habitation is high, that says in his heart, who shall bring me down to the ground? And that was the perception. That's the perception of pride. And Obadiah said, this is terrible. It's the manifestation of pride. What's pride? It is the contemplation of self. What's pride? It is the having self on the throne of our being. What's pride? It is concentration in self as the one object of attention, of observation, of consideration, always everywhere in all things. Pride fills man's nature with self-complacency, with self-admiration, and with self-satisfaction. The poor may be proud, and the rich can also be proud. Self-admiration is at the root of pride. Self-absorption, always thinking about yourself. You're not thinking about God, about your neighbor, about the qualities of other people, about the help of other people, about the contribution of other people to what we're doing. Only yourself. You are the center of gravity for everything. That's pride. Self-absorption is the result of pride. Self-adoration also stems from pride. Pride lifts up a man in his own esteem, that he becomes the only one object of importance, of interest, of devotion. He knows no superior to respect. Those who are proud, even the air around them, they look through the way they look at people and the way they regard people. There is nobody to respect or regard, and no one inferior to regard. They don't look at anybody. They just know that, you know, I'm there. If you are lucky to be around me, you are just lucky. But I am the center of attraction. And, you know, he knows nobody that is superior to him. And no sooner is self-made an idol than it shuts the windows of the inner being against God above and against man below. Pride drives men away from God. What does he need God for? What did Nebuchadnezzar need God for? Nothing. He had the money, he had the wealth, he had the people, he had the governors, he had the captains, he had all the people around him, he had all the food he wanted to eat, and he had all the army, and he had all the instruments of war. What did he need God for? Pride will shut out God from the presence of anyone. Dreaming of independence, pride, placing self where God ought to be, and refusing to recognize any being above or below, external to it. That is a great annual sin in the sight of God. In many passages of scripture, we have a full-length portrait of the proud drawn by the unerring word of truth. Pride renders God a disagreeable object of worship to the sinner. Pride consists in an unduly exalted opinion of oneself. It is therefore impatient of a rival. Hates a superior and cannot endure a master. Pride hates anybody that is superior to him, because he feels that that person that is superior to him, he should not be there. He's a usurper. He actually should be there. That's what pride sees. Pride sees all those people above me. How did they get there, by the way? Anybody trying to control me or direct me? Anybody trying to be my master, trying to say, do it this way and do it this way? How did he get there? Because he feels the greatest in the universe, and nobody should be giving him or should be calling him short at his life. And so that's what pride does. It prevents sinners from seeking the true knowledge of God and then making them unwilling to be taught. Pride makes the proud to feel self-sufficient, and that's a great hindrance to many wise men after the flesh. And that's why we're told in Psalm 10 verse 4. Let's look at Psalm 10 verse 4 and see this effect of pride in the life of anyone. In Psalm 10 verse 4, the wicked through the pride of his countenance, the wicked because of his pride, here is what it says, will not seek after God. God is not in all his thoughts. The rich, what are they praying for? They have all the money they want. Those who are healthy and strong, those athletes, what do they need God for? They have practice and they have all the strength, and they know that they're going to break the record. And then the scientists, what do they know? They think it's all evolution, and this atom and this other one colliding together for all those ages, and then eventually an ape came, and eventually a human being came. In fact, they even want to start now to see whether they can create a human being and put some things together and let inanimate objects produce life, and then they can say, hey, look at it, we're also like God, we're able to create. That's what human beings are. And because of the pride of their heart, there's no thought of God in their mind. I pray God will deliver us. In Ezekiel chapter 28, I'm reading from verse 17. Ezekiel chapter 28, and we're reading from verse 17. In verse 17, thine heart was lifted up. It's the problem of the heart. Pride starts from the heart. Thy heart was lifted up because of thy beauty. Thou hast corrupted thy wisdom by reason of thy brightness. I will cast thee down to the ground. I will lay thee before kings that they may behold thee. You see, it's starting from the heart. I told you when we read Isaiah chapter 14, the creature trying to envy the creator, the child trying to envy the father, and the human being trying to envy even the angels of God. In 2 Samuel chapter 15, 2 Samuel chapter 15, we're looking at verse 4. 2 Samuel chapter 15 verse 4, and Absalom said, moreover, oh, that I were made judge in the land, that every man which has any suit or cause might come unto me, and I would do him justice. He was envious of his father. And this is the father that had had mercy on him. He was actually a criminal. He was a murderer. And then he went into exile. And Joab pleaded for him. You must know the story. And eventually he came back. And eventually his father was merciful and received him graciously. And now he was stay at the court while David would be inside and would be sitting there on the throne, and those who have anything will be coming to him. As those people were coming, he'll accost them. He'll say, stop, where are you going? I want to go and see the king. What do you want to see him for? This is my problem. Oh, If I were the deputy to the king, I'll do you justice. But you know the king feels that he knows everything. He doesn't have any assistant, he doesn't have any deputy. But if I were made a judge in the land, envy, but because of pride, he forgot he should have died. And he forgot he should have been judged. He forgot if he had followed the law of God given by Moses from from Exodus and Leviticus and Numbers and Deuteronomy. He would have been stoned dead because of what he did. But he forgot the mercy of God. And now he began to scheme. Look at verse 5. And it was so that when any man came near to him to do him obeisance, he put forth his hand and he took him and he kissed him. And on this manner did Absalom to all Israel that came to the king for judgment. So Absalom stole the hearts of the men of Israel. You're not talking about stealing money. In fact, this is even more serious than stealing money. If the people that steal money, if they are judged and disciplined and gotten out of the place, how about the people that steal the hearts of the people? They steal their hearts away from God. The people will honor them more than they honor God. The people will obey them more than they obey God. The people will fear them more than we fear Jesus, more than we fear the Lord. Stealing the minds and the hearts of the people away from the Lord. And it was pride that got me to this. We're looking at verse 10. But Absalom sent spies throughout all the tribes of Israel, saying, as soon as ye hear the sound of the trumpet, then ye shall say, Absalom reigneth in Hebron. And with Absalom went 200 men out of Jerusalem that were called, and they went in their simplicity, and they knew not anything. Those people were thoughtless people themselves. They knew nothing about it. They didn't know the heart. They didn't know his purpose. They didn't know his desire. They didn't know his goal. They didn't know his dream. They didn't know his ambition. And because they didn't know in their simplicity, they just followed sheepishly. I pray God will deliver us in Jesus' name. We're looking at Jeremiah chapter 50, verses 31 and 32. Jeremiah chapter 50. And we're looking at verse 31 and verse 32. Chapter 50, verse 31. Behold, I am against thee, thou most proud. Behold, I'm against thee, O thou most proud, says the Lord God of hosts. For thy day is come, the time that I will visit thee, and the most proud shall stumble and fall, and none shall raise him up. And I will kindle a fire in his cities, and it shall devour all around him. We come to point number 2, the punishment and the perdition of the proud. The punishment and the perdition of the proud. We're looking at Daniel chapter 4. Daniel chapter 4. We're reading from verse 28. Daniel chapter 4, verse 28 to verse 33. All this came upon the king Nebuchadnezzar at the end of 12 months. He watched in the palace of the kingdom of Babylon. And the king spake and said, is not this great Babylon that I have built for the house of the kingdom by the might of my power and for the honor of my majesty? While the word was in the king's mouth, there fell a voice from heaven, saying, O king Nebuchadnezzar, to thee it is spoken, the kingdom is departed from thee, and they shall drive thee from men, and thy dwelling shall be with the beasts of the field. They shall make thee eat grass as oxen, and 7 times 7 years shall pass over thee, until thou know that the Most High ruleth in the kingdom of men, and giveth thee to whomsoever he will. The same hour was a sinful field upon Nebuchadnezzar, and he was driven from men, and did eat grass as oxen, and his body was wet with the dew of heaven, till his ears were grown like eagle's feathers, and his nails like bird's claws. That's the punishment that came upon him. Look at verse 37. He realized later that that was punishment, the abasement. That was punishment. It says now, I, Nebuchadnezzar, praise and extol and honor the King of heaven, all whose works are truth and his ways judgment. And those that walk in pride, what's God able to do? Is able to abase them, is able to abase. In Daniel chapter 5 verse 20, Daniel chapter 5 verse 20, and when his heart was lifted up, and his mind hardened in pride. You know that pride hardens people. If somebody is really proud, and then an angel may even come to speak to him from